Hello, welcome to Nurs 242. Today we are going to look at session 6, still on common childhood diseases part 3, and we are going to talk about anemia. We'll look at forms of anemia, describe the causes of anemia, mention clinical manifestations of children with anemia, and describe management of children with anemia. So what is anemia? Anemia is the most common disorder in infants and children. It is defined as a reduction in the number and quality of circulatory red blood cells when the hemoglobin content is below the normal level for particular age, resulting in decreased oxygen carrying capacity. WHO cut-off points for HB estimation for different groups are as follows. From 6 months to 6 years is 11 grams per deciliter. From 6 years to 14 years is 12 grams per deciliter. And above 14 years, males is 13 grams per deciliter. Then female, 12 grams per deciliter. That is WHO cutoff point for HB estimation. WHO grading of anemia. For mild anemia, that is when the child has 10 gram per deciliter. Moderate, 7 gram to 10 gram per deciliter. And severe, below 7 gram per deciliter. Classification of anemia. It can be according to the shape or the causes. There are three causes. These are hemopoietic anemia, hemorrhagic anemia, and hemolytic anemia. We'll look at them one by one. Hemopoietic anemia. This is impaired formation or production. Causes are nutritional deficiencies such as decreased dietary intake, such as iron, B12, and B6. Then we have increased demand. Example is growth. Then decreased absorption, such as B12 and folic acid, which helps in the formation of the blood. Then when there is bone marrow failure, it can also lead to a hemopoietic anemia, such as aplastic anemia. Decreased electrophoresis, and this is usually caused by infection, hepatic diseases, and malignancies. All these are the causes of hemopoietic anemia. Let's look at hemorrhagic anemia. Hemorrhagic anemia is as a result of increased blood loss. And the causes are acute, we have trauma, bleeding from the nose, in patients with leukemia, hemophilia, hemorrhagic diseases of the newborn. And then we have chronic, we have hookworm, bleeding pus, and chronic dysentery, because they lose a lot of blood. The third one that I want us to look at is hemolytic anemia. Hemolytic, this is increased destruction of the red blood cells. The red blood cells are formed, but they are being destroyed. And causes are due to intrinsic and extrinsic factors. For the intrinsic factors, we have membrane defects, we have enzyme defects, and we have hemoglobin defects such as sickle cell or HB electrophoresis. For the extrinsic factors, you have infections such as malaria, you have poisoning, you have drugs, lead poisoning, and extensive burns. You also have antibody reactions such as razors or ABO incompatibility. Classification is also based on the mean cell volume, that's the MCV, and the shape appearance of the red blood cells, that's the size, the color, and the shape. So for the microcytic, as the name goes, micro, we have small and hypochromic pale anemia. So microcytic hypochromic anemia means that there's small pale red blood cells and low MCV. The MCV is the mean corpuscular volume, or the mean cell volume, and is a measure of the average volume of red blood cells in the blood. So the second one is the macro. The microcytic is large red blood cells with high MCV. Then we have the normocytic, normochronic anemia. That is when you have the normal cells. The general signs and symptoms of anemia. You have shortness of breath, especially on exercise. You have weakness, you have lethargy, palpitation, headache, insomnia, dizziness, and jaundice. So this is a child with anemia. Their hands, the conjunctiva, and the mucous membrane are white. I say that this is a paper white pallor. If nothing is done, you can lose the child in a twinkle of an eye. Look at the first image. When diagnostic tools are not available, you can compare the palm of the child with the palm of the caregiver or the mother. So with the first image, you can see that the child is really, really anemic. The conjunctiva is pale and the mucous membrane as well. So on the general signs and symptoms, we've talked about pallor, as you just saw in the previous image. You have tachycardia, then you have bounding pulse and cardiomegaly. So we'll look at different types of anemia. The first one we want to look at is iron deficiency anemia. Iron deficiency anemia is due to deficiency in iron. There is deficiency in iron characterized by small red blood cells with less than the normal content of Hb. It is the most common anemia and the most common nutritional disorders in children. Causes, we have inadequate intake of iron, and this is as a result of rapid growth rate, excessive milk intake, delayed addition of solid food, poor eating habits can also lead to iron deficiency anemia. Then inadequate iron store at birth, example, low birth weight and prematurity or multiple pregnancy. When one is growing, the demand is high. So as a result, it leads to iron deficiency anemia, impaired absorption, and the example is malabsorption syndrome, and blood loss, acute or chronic hemorrhage or worm infestation. They can all lead to iron deficiency anemia. So let's look at the clinical features. You have, I'll mention a few of them. You have pallor, anorexia, you have overweight. Sometimes when our babies are overweight, we think that they have enough iron. It doesn't work like that. Some of them may be overweight, but maybe having iron deficiency anemia. Irritability, you have fatigue, you have spoon or concave fingernails. Sometimes there's cardiac dilatation, and they crave for pica and so on and so forth. There is also decreased attentiveness, short attention span, reduced cognitive performance, then decreased physical performance and reduced exercise tolerance. You can diagnose by just checking the Hb, the red cell indices, then blood smear, checking for whether it's hypochromic or microcytic. Then you also check for platelet counts, whether it's high or low. You can manage iron deficiency by detecting and treating the underlying cause. Then you have to improve dietary intake, especially iron-containing foods, chronic blood loss like rectal polyps, chronic dysentery or ulcerative colitis should be diagnosed and treated adequately. Iron therapy can be given through oral routes, IM or IV, depending on the child's condition. Vitamin C should be given because it promotes absorption. Milk diminishes absorption of iron, so should be avoided around the time of administration of iron. But one common thing is teeth discoloration from the liquid iron. So in this case, especially for infants, you can use a dropper or a straw for younger children, or rinsing the mouth with water after taking the oral liquid iron. Then parents should be informed tools will be black because of the medication. If you don't tell them, they will come back with their children or stop the medication, telling you that the color of their stools, of their child's stool has changed, and because of that they are not comfortable. So you need to inform them. Oxygen therapy is given when there is severe tissue hypoxia. Blood transfusion is indicated only in severe cases of anemia and deworming should be done and other supportive care provided. Nursing management, you give diets containing iron and protein. You have to give the iron therapy. You give emotional support. Then you monitor child's condition, maintain hygiene care and health education. You have to give counseling on what the child is supposed to eat. Then you also encourage breastfeeding, and these will prevent the child from getting iron deficiency anemia. Still on the prevention of preterm and low birth weight. Then you also have to control infections during prenatal or neonatal period. Then introduction of semi-solid and solid food from 6 months of age as complementary feedings. Adequate treatment of worm infestations and chronic illness. And you also have to improve of personal and environmental hygiene. All these help to prevent iron deficiency in children. The next one that we will look at is aplastic anemia. It's caused by bone marrow depression and production of blood cells in the bone marrow is reduced or is lacking. Sometimes there's failure to produce adequate red blood cells, white blood cells, and platelets. Causes, we have a lot of causes. We have congenital, it can be inherited as an autosomal recessive trait. Then it can also be acquired through infections such as viral infections like HIV, hepatitis B, or bacterial infection, exposure to radiation, and certain drugs such as confenicol and sulfonamides. Signs and symptoms include excessive drowsiness, there is paleness, irritability, the child easily gets tired, there is anorexia, lack of appetite, then bleeding through the nose or the GIT, and easy bruising. There's also pancytopenia. Diagnosis is by clinical manifestation, blood form comment, and bone marrow biopsy. Management for children with aplastic anemia is mainly supportive care, bone marrow transplantation, and immunotherapy. Treatment of infections and bleeding, blood transfusions, and steroid therapy. So these are all management of aplastic anemia. Let's look at megaloblastic anemia. Megaloblastic, as the name goes, the red blood cells are abnormally large. These cells are actually immature erythrocytes. They are caused by folic acid deficiencies and vitamin B12 deficiency. There is an essential factor needed for the production of a normal red blood cells. It is the intrinsic anti-anemic factor. When it's not available to the bone marrow, excessive large red blood cells called megaloblastic cells are formed. So look at the folic acid deficiency. It is due to folate deficiency in children. As the condition progresses, the number of red blood cells decreases while the size increases. Sources of folate, you can get it from plants such as green leafy vegetables. You can get it from animals such as liver, kidney, meat, egg, and yolk. So the cause is mainly low intake of folate. Some drugs can also lead to malabsorption as well as alcohol. Disease of the jejunum and hookworm may also interfere. If the child is hemolyzing, there is an increased demand for production of new red blood cells and consequently for folic acid. Signs and symptoms include skin being pale, brittle nails, dry hair, pale conjunctiva, dyspnea. The child easily gets tired and tachycardia. The child also presents with headache, dizziness, smooth sore red tongue, mild diarrhea, and deep hyperpigmentation. Diagnosis, when HB is usually low, then HB film comments. They actually show enlarged and few red blood cells. The management, you give the child food rich in folic acid, then folic acid tablet 5 mg daily, as well as vitamin C. Let's look at vitamin B12, that is pernicious anemia. Vitamin B12 is found in the liver, kidney, and milk, but not in vegetables. So, of course, a disease in the stomach can cause malabsorption of vitamin B12. Then also inadequate or low intake of vitamin B12 can lead to pernicious anemia. Signs and symptoms include the skin becoming pale, the nails becoming brittle, the hair becoming dry, pale conjunctiva, the child has difficulty in breathing, the child easily gets tired, there is tachycardia, there is headache and dizziness. All these are part of the signs and symptoms. Then the diagnosis, you also do form comments. They will show large and very few red blood cells, low serum levels of vitamin B12. So what do? You manage by giving a lifelong IM injection of vitamin B12, and the dose is repeated monthly. So now we are moving on to sickle cell anemia. The image on the screen is a picture of a sickle red blood cell and the normal red blood cells. So these are the normal red blood cells and the sickle red blood cells. So let's see what usually happens in sickle cell disease or anemia. It's an inherited disease of the red blood cells that affect the hemoglobin. Insufficient oxygen causes cell to assume a sickle shape rather than a normal one. So if there is insufficient oxygen, the cell is going to assume this shape. The red blood cells are going to, instead of the normal round shape. These cells cannot flow through the small red blood vessels, and this leads to vaso occlusion. So when they become sickle, it's a bit difficult for them to flow through the tiny blood vessel, and this leads to vaso occlusive crisis, which we are going to discuss very soon. The cells are responsive to adequate oxygenation and hydration. After repeated sickling, the cells become permanent sickled. So this is a normal red blood cells. The normal shape is deformable. It has a lifespan of 120 days. Then the shape of a sickle cell. It is rigid and lives for only 20 days compared to 120 days. So it means that for this one, there's going to be rapid breakdown of red blood cells for this particular one. Let's look at the types of sickle cell disease that we have. We have the HBSS, the sickle cell anemia. We have the HBSC disease, which is the sickle cell disease, and the beta thalassemia. Let's look at precipitating factors contributing to crisis. They get crisis. We have fever, we have altitude, extreme temperatures, vomiting, fatigue, alcohol consumption, pregnancy. Somebody will ask, why pregnancy? We are talking about children. But we know that children around 13, 14, 15 years are also getting pregnant. And according to WHO, that a child is someone below the age of 18 years. So we can talk about pregnancy here, dehydration, emotional or physical stress, infection, hypoxia, respiratory acidosis. This can precipitate the child to have crisis. Clinical manifestation are primarily the result of obstruction caused by sickle red blood cells and increased sickle red blood cells destruction. Let's look at the clinical manifestation. You have anemia, you have shortness of breath, dizziness, headache, coldness of the hands and feet. You have palpitation, weakness, irritability, cough, anorexia, joint pains, jaundice, pain, hematuria, bacterial sepsis, and paroxysm. Chronic, you can have anemia, you can have jaundice, you have the spleen enlarging, the heart also enlarging, and delayed growth and sexual maturation. We have different types of crises that they usually experience. The first one is the recurrent vaso-occlusive crisis. We have the splenic sequestration, the aplastic crisis, and the acute chest syndrome. Suspect any of the following crises in a patient with sickle cell anemia who has pale lips, tongue, palm, or nail beds, or the patient presents with lethargy or sleeplessness, irritability, or severe pain and fever. Look at anemic crisis. What is anemic crisis? The anemia in sickle cell disease is caused by red blood cell destructions or hemolysis. A normal red blood cell will take about 120 days before it breaks down. But in sickle cell, it takes 20 days or less. So there is rapid destruction or hemolysis. It is caused by diminished production and increased destruction of the red blood cells triggered by viral infection or depletion of folic acid. That is why folic acid are taken by sickle cell patients for life. Then signs include profound anemia and pallor. Let's talk about the second crisis, that's the vaso-occlusive crisis. This one occurs when the rigid sickle cell shaped cells, they clump together. So when they become rigid and they clump together, they obstruct capillary blood flow, and this leads to tissue hypoxia. When it happens like that, then the patient will start having pain, fever, severe abdominal pain, and tissue engorgement or damage to the organs, because the organs are going to be depleted of oxygen. There's also cerebral occlusion, which can result in stroke. Yeah, children can also have stroke or paralysis or other central nervous complication. Let's move on to the third crisis, that is splenic sequestration. It's a sudden life-threatening crisis. What happens is that there is trapping of blood within the spleen and usually occurs in infants below 2 years of age with the SS genotype. The spleen enlarged on physical examination may not be associated with fever, pain, respiratory, or other symptoms. But the only thing that you see on examination is that it is enlarged. Circulatory collapse and death can occur within hours. In this case, we need to act very fast. Clinical manifestations include profound anemia, hypovolemia, and shock. The last one is the acute chest syndrome. And then for this particular one, there is fever, there is respiratory symptoms, and the causes are mostly as a result of infection and fat emboli. For infants, before age 4 months, symptoms are rare because of the fetal hemoglobin. The fetal hemoglobin prevents excessive sickling. So around this time, even if you go and check for sickling, you will not actually see whether the child is sickle cell patient or not. So we advise that we wait till the child is a bit grown before we check the sickling status. Before age 4 months, symptoms are rare because the fetal hemoglobin prevents excessive sickling. So when you do the sickling test, the child will come out as negative. Then colic from pain caused by abdominal infection, which is very, very painful. Hand-foot syndrome from infection of the small bones of the hands and feet. Then the spleen enlarges from sequestrated red blood cells. For toddlers and preschoolers, there is hypovolemia and shock from sequestration of large amounts of blood in the spleen. There is pain at site of vaso-occlusive crisis. There is possible functional asplenia by age 4, leading to increased risk of infection. For school-age children, adolescents, there is delayed growth and development and delayed sexual maturity. There is enuresis, there is extreme pain at the site of crisis, there is poor healing of leg wounds from inadequate peripheral circulation of oxygenated blood. So you see them having wounds on their legs, and their wounds takes a very long time to heal. For the boys, they have priapism, and I'm sure you all know what priapism is. Diagnosis, we have the cyclin test and the 8B electrophoresis. It can be done in infants. You have to wait for them to grow a little because of the fetal hemoglobin. Because most authorities are saying that they are not sure the time the fetal hemoglobin disappears. So after 1 year, you can comfortably go and do the cyclin test. Management. Management focuses on psychological care, pain control, hydration, oxygenation, transfusion, bed rest, prevention of infection, prevention of complication, and prevention of crisis. So I have discussed them in detail. We have the psychological care, which you can look at later. So that is how we manage patients with sickle cell. So health education. Health education and prevention of crisis. Infection should be prevented. You tell the mothers that prevention of infection is very, very important because infection can lead to crisis. Example is the malaria, because they are going to break down red blood cells. It can lead to all sorts of problems for the patient. Patients must avoid working under stressful condition. Patients should avoid strenuous physical activities and exertion, and exertive exercise must be minimized. So if the child is in school, you tell the teachers, especially the physical education teacher, they should be aware that this child is a sickle cell patient. Patient must avoid extreme cold by dressing appropriately. Educate patients and family on the importance of avoiding low oxygen areas. Example is high altitude. The parents should also be educated on the signs of dehydration and the importance to avoid overheating as a source of heat loss. They must also avoid taking drugs that causes hemolysis. So in short, you have to tell them that they should make sure they don't buy over-counter drugs. They should take prescriptions before they buy. Patients should take their medications, you know, regularly. And you know, they are always on folic acid, so we should ensure that they take it, you know. In addition, we also have to educate patients to attend sickle cell clinics. This is the hand-foot syndrome that I was talking about. It's early complication of sickle cell. Highest incidence is around 6 months to 2 years, and it's usually painful. Treatment involves giving fluids and pain medication. So this is the hand and foot syndrome. So you can imagine a 6 month old having this complication. The chronic complications include anemia or jaundice, brain damage or stroke, you have kidney failure, decreased lung function, eye disease, and lung leg ulcers, because the ulcers takes a long time for it to heal. So you are expected to read on malaria and leukemia as your assignment. Today we have been looking at anemia, which is very common in children. We have looked at the three main types of anemia: hemopoietic, hemorrhagic, and hemolytic anemia. Thank you.